Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Agitators, Three Friends Who Fought for Abolition and Women's Rights, by Dorothy Wickenden. Read by Anne Twomey, Gabra Zackman, and Heather Alicia Sims, with a prologue and closing comment read by the author.
God's ahead of Master Lincoln. God won't let Master Lincoln beat the South till he does the right thing. Master Lincoln, he's a great man, and I'm a poor Negro. But this Negro can tell Master Lincoln how to save the money and the young men. He can do it by setting the Negroes free. Harriet Tubman, January 1862.
Prologue. Fort Hill Cemetery, high above the city of Auburn in central New York State, is not one of those cramped, fenced-in graveyards often found behind old churches with weather-scoured slabs tipping into the earth. On grounds once occupied by a fortress built by the Cayuga Nation, it meanders up and around 83 acres of grass and old-growth forest. Fort Hill retained some of the wildness the region had when the first white settlers arrived after the Revolutionary War, so sprawling that many of the gravestones, obelisks, and crypts, as various as the people they commemorate, are almost hidden in the landscape. Buried there are three women whose joint story of insubordination against slavery and the oppression of women has never been told: Harriet Tubman, Martha Coffin Wright, and Francis A. Seward. Much of American history is made by little-known people living far from Washington. Over the course of a decade in the 1850s, when Auburn was a thriving commercial center and well-off white men seemed destined always to rule the country unchallenged, Harriet Tubman was a nameless freedom seeker who repeatedly risked her life returning to the Eastern Shore to guide some 70 enslaved people out of Maryland, through Delaware and Pennsylvania, across New York, and into Canada. Soon after Tubman liberated herself, she met Martha Wright and Frances Seward, who lived in Auburn, midway on what became one of her most well-traveled Underground Railroad routes. Wright, a middle-class Quaker mother of six, helped to organize the 1848 Seneca Falls Convention, the first women's rights meeting in America. Seward was the wealthy wife of the anti-slavery politician William H. Seward, who, esteemed by some and despised by others, rose from governor of New York to United States senator to secretary of state under Abraham Lincoln. When Martha Wright and Frances Seward got to know Tubman, they were in the process of transforming themselves from conventional homemakers into insurgents who fought to overturn slavery and to demand the dignity and equality of all Americans. Tubman saw Wright and Seward as two of her most trusted associates, and they drew strength and inspiration from her. In the coming decades, these women, with no evident power to change anything, became co-conspirators and intimate friends, protagonists in an inside-out story about the Second American Revolution.
Part 1. Provocations, 1821 to 1852. Chapter 1. A Nantucket Inheritance, 1833 to 1843. Martha Coffin Wright's mutinous mind had its origins in a place she never lived, a jagged 14-mile-long fishhook of an island 30 miles off the coast of Massachusetts. She rarely encountered an institution she didn't question, and although convention dictated most of the circumstances of her life, she liked breaking rules and then explaining why she had no choice. Her parents, Anna Folger Coffin and Thomas Coffin, were Quaker descendants of two of the first English settlers who had fled the Massachusetts Bay Colony rather than submit to the fines, floggings, and prison terms the Puritan clergy imposed on anyone who bucked church dogma. The women of Nantucket took for granted their equality with men. Mary Coffin Starbuck, Martha's great-great-grandaunt, ran the island's first general store out of her house on Fair Street and traded with the Wampanoag Indians, tools, cloth, shoes, and kettles in exchange for fish and feathers. In 1708, Starbuck organized the island's first meeting of the Society of Friends, and she became a minister, a position closed to women of other denominations. The Nantucket Quakers opposed slavery, which was legal in all 13 colonies, holding early meetings to advocate abolition. As financiers of the whaling business, they were at once frugal and profit-minded. The Coffin family was a matriarchy, headed by Martha's mother, Anna, and Martha's tiny but indomitable sister, Lucretia Coffin Mott, who was 14 years older than she was. Anna kept her own small store and taught her children to oppose slavery and to practice the Nantucket way, the egalitarian social and business relations followed on the island. Martha's father, Thomas, had been a whaling captain like his ancestors, one of the most dangerous professions in the world. A harpooned whale could eliminate a boatload of harpooners with a single thrash of its tail. In 1800, Thomas switched to the somewhat safer business of trading, buying sealskins in South American ports and exchanging them in China for soft Nankin cloth and silk, tea and porcelain. But he was still gone for years at a time, and he and Anna finally moved the family to Boston, where Thomas started an import business. Martha, the last of their five living children, was born there on Christmas Day in 1806. 3 years later, the Coffins moved to Philadelphia, and Thomas bought a factory that produced cut nails. Quakers in Philadelphia had their own anti-slavery tradition, but a fractious one. Many friends owned slaves until 1775, when the city's Quaker meeting called upon all members who hadn't freed them to do so. That year, Quakers led the founding of the first abolition group in America, the Society for the Relief of Free Negroes Unlawfully Held in Bondage. By 1789, the elderly Benjamin Franklin, a former owner of two slaves, was president of the organization, renamed the Pennsylvania Abolition Society, which worked with the Free African Society to create black schools and to help black residents find jobs. Anna Coffin proudly informed her children that Franklin was a first cousin of her great-grandfather, Nathan Fulcher. In 1827, when Quakers split into two groups, the egalitarian Hicksites and the hierarchical scripture-following Orthodox, Anna and her family strongly allied themselves with the most liberal of the Hicksites, whom other Philadelphians deplored. Thomas died from typhus when Martha was eight, leaving her mother in debt. Anna, drawing on her experience as a shopkeeper and her husband's as a trader, opened a store selling goods from East India. In 1821, at the age of 26, Lucretia followed the example of Mary Coffin Starbuck, becoming a Quaker minister. She and her husband, the wool merchant James Mott, were abolitionists. But it was Lucretia whose work often took her out of town, and James who cared for their five children when she was away, with help from Anna. In Philadelphia, Lucretia and James made themselves unwelcome in polite society by socializing with anti-slavery friends, including members of the black middle class. As a young woman, Martha had a mischievous, elfin look. Her curls escaping her bonnet, her eyes flashing, she was funny, willful, and outspoken. She had resented the strict regulations and prim teachers at her Quaker girls' school, later commenting to Lucretia that she never saw the little urchins creeping like snails unwillingly to school without rejoicing that I am not one of them. Anna supplemented her income by turning the family home into a boarding house, and Martha, at 16, fell in love with one of the boarders, Peter Pelham. A 37-year-old army captain who had fought the British in the War of 1812, Pelham had lingering ailments from a bullet wound in his upper thigh. Martha found him worldly and romantic, and soon he was wooing her with poetry books by the popular British writer Oliver Goldsmith, slipping love letters between the pages. Anna disapproved, and so did Lucretia, who was a second mother to her. Martha was too young, and Pelham was a non-Quaker, a military man, and the son of Kentucky slaveholders. Refusing to give him up, Martha married Pelham in 1826, shortly before she turned 18, and they moved to Fort Brooke in the Florida Territory. She described her exhilaration at living far from the conventionalities that interfered with one's freedom of action. Upon receiving a letter of expulsion from Philadelphia's Society of Friends for marrying outside the meeting, she tartly replied that she found the rule regrettable, and she continued to call herself a Quaker. According to the teachings of Friends, men and women were equal in the eyes of God, and everyone contained a divine spark, an inner light. Martha interpreted those beliefs as permission to follow her principles. When she got pregnant, she returned to Philadelphia and realized how much she had missed the commotion and culture of urban life, the markets, libraries and bookstores, theaters, and the lively discussions in her own family. In 1826, not long after Martha's daughter, Mariana, was born, Peter died from complications of his war wound, leaving her a widow and a mother at 19. She expected to live in Philadelphia, but Anna was moving.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.